of investment, because there is really no access on the Tiger River Basin right now. There's a great diversity of features. You have Tiger River in urban areas, which would allow for quick afternoon paddles, and then you have more scenic rural areas. You also have reservoirs, flat water sections for beginners, and then you have white water along the Tiger, which is great for teaching on, and there's some sections that are great for intermediate paddlers as well. Furthermore, we have support from several key partners, especially the Tiger River Foundation, and that's going to be essential to advancing this project. And the Tiger River Foundation is a nonprofit volunteer organization formed in 2007, and they strive to promote, protect, and restore the natural and historic resources of the Tiger River Basin and encourage an active outdoor lifestyle. Generally speaking, we share the same goals with the Tiger River Foundation, but until recently, we haven't worked that closely together on significant projects to bring access to the Tiger River. Tiger River Foundation will open the first public access on the Tiger River coming up likely next spring. It's 10 acres just below the confluence of the South and North Tigers, and that will be titled Tiger 10 Park. But even more importantly, Tiger River Foundation has long cultivated key relationships with community stakeholders and riverfront property owners, and that should allow us to attain property by the deadline that accompanies the COP's expenditure. In addition to this, we'll be working together to ensure that all riverfront property is designated as public access permanently, and we'll be working with county attorneys on that as well. Tiger River Foundation will gladly tell you that as an all-volunteer organization, they can't do all this by themselves, and they welcome the new partnership. And that result's going to be we're going to create more river access in a quicker time frame than either of us could do alone. And this example is really just an example of our new agency-wide effort to work towards community recreational goals with partners when that's appropriate. And we've tentatively labeled our effort the Tiger River Water Trail, and we plan to use the allocated COPS funding for the purchase of as many tactical riverfront properties as possible. And that will prepare up to 44 miles of river for access. And we're in strong agreement with the Tiger River Foundation on which sections are most desirable for the recreational user. And again, Tiger River Foundation has made great inroads with some property owners, and we feel we'll be able to move fairly quickly on several of these properties.
Can I ask another question, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Who's going to keep these rivers? Is Corps of Engineers going to clear these rivers for you?
No, the Corps will not do that, but we do. You'll find that we already have a strong volunteer base that works to clear those rivers periodically. Part of that's Tiger River Foundation. Part of that's folks that just want to go out and paddle themselves. And with the outdoor recreation staff we have as well, that'll be an opportunity for them to get out on the river, check the safety of it, remove any obstacles that they can remove, or organize a work day to do so.
Well, most of my concerns with the smaller rivers like the Henry or the Tigers are there ever flood and rain that comes along plots those things up, and
I don't know
on some of these rivers, and I don't see them clean. The fact that the river is large enough that storms are not going to block it to where you can't get through, but some of the smaller ones, such as the South and North, Center Tiger, Emory, they're a disaster.
I can tell you
talking about going all the way through. Now, if you're talking about slow water, there's certain sections, but.
Sure, I can tell you from experience in paddling other rivers of this size that once you build the accommodations for folks to use the river, they take ownership of it, and it's much easier to get volunteers out there to help you out with those problems. And you know, any moving system like the river, you are going to have chips and trees and sand and all that stuff, and that's something that you do deal with regularly.
And it's very dangerous to cut them out. Some of these trees, I've done a lot of it myself.
But I can tell you we do have folks on staff that are trained and certified, not specifically for river removal, but for using chainsaws and to do it in a safe manner.
I've always had a liability concern with the smaller rivers. That's not something that is cropped up. I've said the fact is large enough that you're not going to have a tree fall across it. Mm-hmm. The broad is large enough that you don't have a tree fall across it. I'll clubhouse, I've seen people lose their lives in them where the river was clogged, and the hydraulics are terrible. Everybody's got an inner tube. If you've got an excess, everybody's got an inner tube to come go there and get in. We just want to make sure it's a safe thing.
And we'll develop a plan going forward to ensure that the rivers are free and clear and safe.
Okay. Tony, that's a good point, Roger. I know we got to hustle up, but I see this as a big bonus for you, because you know we have a lot of flooding from those creeks and the lake across the state, and we have volunteers to come up, because we know you can't get a core in here. I've asked time and time again, and I think this would be a big plus to help abate some flooding problems we may have to.
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Okay. Map you see here just kind of divides the first phase of the Tiger River water trail into sections. You'll see 10 different river sections here. They're all about 4.4 miles in length. Again, the spacing of those access sites will allow for somebody to do a quick run after work or after school, or you can make a full day out of it on the weekend by combining some of those contiguous sections. As we fill in some of the noticeable gaps that you see there, and expand the trail up and downstream, as well as develop paddle-in campsites, we'll be able to schedule overnight trips along the trail as well. Adding just 6 more miles to the bottom section of this would connect us to the Tiger River Canoe Trail, and that currently runs 24 miles through Union County and Sumter National Forest, and from there you can paddle all the way down the ocean if you want to. There is a considerable level of uncertainty regarding the cost for land acquisition. And some of the reasons for that is the sizes of the parcels are going to range from 1 to 7 acres in size. Most will be 1 to 3. Urban properties are going to appraise much higher than rural ones. Exact acres will not be known until we start negotiations with property owners. And some property or a portion of the property could be donated, which would reduce our acquisition costs. Nevertheless, based on the data we have, we do estimate that somewhere around 12 sites would be opened up, an average cost of $42,000 per site. And we'll be able to open these sites up for access with just minimal development, and improvements that you see here for our basic access site would include a crusher run driveway and parking area that would accommodate at least 7 vehicles, perimeter fence to keep those vehicles where they need to be, basic footpath down to a natural launching area wherever possible, an information kiosk, additional signage, a gate or camera for security, and we're currently working with the sheriff's office on developing a specific plan for how we're going to protect our investment in the sites.
Eric, I'm going to stop because we've got to move on. Is this something we need to carry over to the main meeting, Jim, or next month, or what's the?
No, sir. Actually, this is just an update. That money is already budgeted, but we thought it was important enough for y'all to listen to it. If y'all have any questions afterwards, listen, please feel free to give Eric a call. He is the expert.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jim.
Roger, can I say something for Eric? I agree with Jeff. I think this is an exciting, really cool project. Now, I'm glad to hear one thing that you mentioned, the partnership with the Tiger River Foundation. And I've heard that over and over and over again. And I also wanted to compliment Jim on economic development projects. You know, on my committee, we didn't have one before us, but we've got a company, a very, very big and very positive contributing company, the Spartanburg. And Jim and his staff have worked with us to help them make a decision to move here to Spartanburg versus another location in the country. And this partnership really says so much about who we are. And again, I just congratulate you, Eric, and Jim, and the Tiger River Foundation, and their chairman out there, on helping us move this ball forward real fast.
And one last piece of good news, Mr. Luton, can you tell us what that is?
Sorry, let me squeeze this in. I actually have Mr. David Butler. He's the vice president of the National Softball Association, with some really big news. Last but not least,
like good news.
Well, hello, Spartanburg County.
Hello.
As he said, my name is David Butler. I'm a vice president with the National Softball Association. We also have a sister organization called the Baseball Players Association. We cover from the West Coast all the way to the East Coast with our sport. my position is I cover from Maine to Florida, so I am a East Sullivan Vice President. Several years ago, John and some of his pals started visiting our convention. We have a convention each year at the end of October. And he was telling us about plans to build Tiger River. He spent a lot of time with me, showing me pictures and so forth, and I didn't pay him a whole lot of attention, to be quite honest with you. But as the years went by, the park became a reality. I always told him if it did, I would participate. We are a governing body in the sport, and I feel like it's important to support ballparks that support the sport that we enjoy so much. So, to live up to a promise that I made to John, we moved along to make arrangements between him and also Chris with the CVB. These guys have been attending meetings and really soliciting our program. So, we have part of our sport is called Girls Fast Pitch. The NSA is a full-service governing body. We have adult, slow pitch. In fact, men's fast pitch, on and on, I won't take much time. One of our programs is girls fast pitch. Y'all guys have a youth ballpark that is just absolutely breathtaking. And you're competing in a very competitive market in South Carolina. South Carolina is blessed with ballparks. So, that being said, you are competing with towns like Orlando, Charlotte, Chattanooga, Panama City Beach, Stillwater Beach. But this year, next year in 2012, we will be bringing our Class A Girls Fast Pitch World Series to Spartanburg. And again, a lot of credit goes to your Parks and Rec Department and your CVB Department. These guys did a good job. Is there any questions I can answer?
How many teams are you talking about?
Our target is 250 to 300.
How many people do these teams bring in with them?
They average, there's 12 players on the team, got two parents, coaches, 24 people per team. And we'll be here for a week. And we will be asking for a lot of cooperation in the community, to be quite honest with you. Okay? These teams will be coming from every state this side of the Mississippi. Indiana, Michigan, Illinois. And there's got to be a reason for them to come to Spartanburg. So we've got quite a job ahead of us to sell the city and make it special. A lot of these people, you know, just probably never even heard of Spartanburg. Just the way it is. So we've got to show them that we're going to put on a show. This is a vacation. They've enjoyed playing ball, and I'm sure there's folks in this room who play softball and enjoy it. But to come down here for a week and compete is still a family vacation. And with the economic situations and drought and so forth, we're competing against Mickey Mouse, sand and the beach and waves. So these guys got some great ideas on what we're going to do and what kind of show we're going to put on. To get these folks to want to come to Spartanburg, spend a week of their life, and have a good time, and go home saying it was great. And of course, our number one shining star is going to be the ballpark Tiger River itself. That's what we have in mind. We think outside the box, and that's what we're doing on this case. So I hope all of y'all wish us very good luck, but we don't need it.
Well, just like I was saying to Jim and his team about partnerships, I know this council, what we're trying to do in Spartanburg, we'll roll out the red carpet, we'll roll up our sleeves, we'll be a part of helping make, you know, this whole tournament a success. And those people know what Spartanburg means when they leave here. It's good hospitality.
Good. Well, one of our things was going to be Southern hospitality. You nailed it right on the head. Yeah. And of course, as you know, we are also working with the Greenville folks.